Several years ago, I was complaining to the Lord that I had absolutely no inspiration for a Christmas sermon. And the Lord spoke to me and he said, the reason you aren't inspired is because you've never really reflected on the meaning of the incarnation. Kaboom. I have to tell you, when the Holy Spirit said that to me, it rocked my world. And when I began to study and reflect on the incarnation, it rocked my world, and it has rocked my world every Christmas since. And my prayer for you this morning is that the meaning of the incarnation would rock your world too. My prayer is that the Holy Spirit would fill your heart with awe and joy and gratitude and affection for the Christ of Christmas. And this is the truth that caused so much celebration in my heart. The incarnation is the ultimate revelation of the Father to us. The incarnation gives us the clearest picture that we have of God's true nature. The incarnation gives us the best glimpse that we have into God's heart. Maybe we could say it like this: Jesus is God's selfie. Jesus shows us what God looks like, not on the outside, but on the inside. John said, the Word became flesh and pitched his tent among us. No man has seen God at any time, but God, the one and only, who was at the Father's side, that's Jesus, has made him known to us. Hebrews says the Son is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being. Paul said he is the image of the unseen God. All the fullness of the Godhead dwelt in him bodily. Jesus said, if you have seen me, then you have seen the Father. So what is it that Jesus in his incarnation has made known to us about the Father? What qualities of the Father radiate to us through the life of the incarnate Son? What qualities of the Father does Jesus precisely represent to us? What does Jesus portray to us about the nature of the Father? As I was reflecting on the incarnation, the Holy Spirit caused three things to jump out at me, and I want to share them with you quickly this morning. Three things that the incarnation shows us about the Father. Three things that the incarnation shows us about the Father. The first one is this: the incarnation shows us that God's nature is essentially relational. Beloved, listen to me. God is a relational God. He is a relationship-seeking God. And the Word became flesh and tabernacled with us, and they shall call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. God is a relational God. It's impossible to understand the Christmas story without going all the way back to the beginning. John says, before the beginning began, God has always existed in a relationship of perfect intimacy and harmony and honor and delight. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit have always coexisted together, co-equally and co-eternally. John says in John chapter 1, they exist face to face with one another. Actually, it's a kind of provocative expression. The picture is of a husband and wife moving towards one another for intimacy. God is a spirit, so that's not literal, but it's a metaphor for the dynamic, ever-increasing intimacy that exists within the Trinity. God's eternal nature is relational. He is a divine relationship at the center of the universe. The very essence of his being is relational. And then God created the heavens and the earth, light and darkness, day and night, sky and sea and land, plants and animals and birds and every creature of the sea. And God saw that all was good. And then God made man from the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. But man himself was not the pinnacle of God's creation, because God looked at the man and saw that he was all alone, and God said, that's not good. God saw that the male lion had a female lion with corresponding body parts that connected them, and God said, that's good. God saw that the male bear had a female bear with body parts that corresponded and connected them, and God said, that's good. But God saw that the man had no one with corresponding body parts. That's what the Hebrew says in Genesis chapter 2, and God said, that's not good. So he took a rib from the man, and he made Eve, and he brought her to the man, and the man said, whew, man, that's good. And God said, let these two become permanently joined together in a bond of exclusive relationship called one flesh. Let these two be joined together in a covenant relationship of mutual affection and honor and submission and care and delight. And what if that is the pinnacle of God's creation? Not a man alone, but a man and a woman united in a mysterious spiritual bond of intimate relationship that creates an earthly picture of the reality of the Trinity. And what if that is really the sense in which we have been created in the image of God, not merely that as individuals we're comprised of three components, body, soul, and spirit, but that we were created to experience the delight of a loving covenant relationship, just as God eternally exists in a loving covenant relationship. This is good preaching, by the way. I'm about to preach myself happy. It's a little deep for Christmas morning, but it's good. God is relational by nature, and he has created us relational too in his own image. The Trinity is one of those divine mysteries that's too wonderful for our finite minds. We struggle to find earthly pictures to help us understand it, and none of them are really satisfying, but we really don't have to look any further because God himself has already given us a much better earthly picture of his triune nature. And that's the one flesh bond of marriage. The one flesh bond of marriage helps us to understand God himself. When we studied the book of 1 Corinthians together, we talked about the importance of fidelity to the one flesh bond of marriage. And here's why it's so important, because the family is God's first vehicle to portray himself to us. The one flesh bond of marriage gives us a glimpse of the inner workings of the Godhead himself. Just like a marriage, the Trinity is a holy relationship of deep commitment and affection and honor and equality and mutual submission. The one flesh bond of marriage also helps us to understand God's motivation for creating us. You see, God is just so big, he overflows. The love within the Godhead is so plentiful that it overflows. The life within him is just so abundant that it has to overflow. It's just like the godly desire of a husband and a wife to create children. Their love for one another is just so good that they want to multiply it by multiplying. Their love for one another is so deep that they want to produce something that's a testament of their love. Their love for one another is so abundant that they want to share the joy of it by adding more people into that circle. And that's precisely why God created us. Beloved, God did not create us because he was needy. He didn't create us because he wanted someone to boss around. He didn't create us because he wanted someone to grovel at his feet. He didn't create us because he was lonely either. God is perfectly complete in himself. He's all the company he ever needed. But he created us because what he had going on inside was too good not to share. His love was so good, it just had to be multiplied to others. His love was so good, it just had to produce something. His love was so good that the joy of it had to be shared. The one flesh bond of marriage also helps us to understand the relationship that God earnestly wants to share with us. Paul said that marriage is an earthly picture of the spiritual bond that we're meant to share with God. In the beginning, in the garden, the man and the woman were bound in a relationship to one another by the Holy Spirit, and they were bound in a relationship to God by the Holy Spirit. But along came the serpent, sowing seeds of doubt. And when Adam and Eve sinned, the Holy Spirit was taken away from them, and their connection to God was lost, and their connection to one another was seriously damaged. And that brings us to the incarnation. Why did God become a man? Without ceasing to be God in any regard, God the Son assumed a human nature into his divine nature. And he assumed a body of human flesh into his divine being. And he stepped into human history and he dwelt among us. Why did he do that? Well, God became a man because his nature is essentially relational, and he created us relational too. Specifically, he created us to share a love relationship with him. God became a man not because he needs us, but because he wants us. Jesus prayed in John 17, "Father, I want those that you have given me to be with me where I am." He became God with us precisely because he wants to get with us. God became a man because he is not a celestial loner. He is an incurable lover. God became a man because he refuses to ever give up on us. God became a man to pursue us. He became a man to woo us and wow us, to win us back, to wed us, and then to welcome us home into his presence. The incarnation is God's invitation to us to join the loving relationship that exists in the center of the universe through Christ. Three things that the incarnation shows us about the Father. He's relational, number one. Number two, the incarnation shows us that God's nature is infinitely humble. God is humble. If you've ever studied systematic theology, it usually begins with the attributes of God. What is God like? God is a spirit. God is one. God is eternal. God is holy. God is just. God is love. God is immutable. That means he cannot change. God is omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent, transcendent, immanent. But here's one that you never hear. God is humble. Now, there's a paradoxical thought if you've ever heard one. How can the infinite, eternal God, the creator of everything, the one who lives in unapproachable light, how can it be said of him that he is humble? And yet, that's precisely what the incarnate Son radiates to us about the Father. That's precisely what Jesus represents to us, what he portrays to us about the Father. In Philippians 2, Paul talks about the humility of God displayed in the incarnate Son. Looking at his words, I find, first of all, that God was humble before the incarnation. Paul says, although the Son was always in his very nature God, he did not strive for equality with the Father. You see, that tells us something important about the relationship dynamics within the Godhead. It's a beautiful atmosphere of mutual honor and submission. There is no power struggle in the Godhead. The Son is joyfully submitted to the Father. The Spirit is joyfully submitted to the Father and the Son. And the Father, Son, and the Spirit are madly in love with one another. That means that humility is the very essence of God's being. Humility wasn't just a temporary phase for Jesus while he accomplished the work of our redemption on earth. Humble is what Jesus has always been. Before the incarnation, before the foundation of the world was laid, his nature was already the slain lamb. But then the extent of God's humility was fully displayed in the incarnation of the Son. Paul says he made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant and being made in the likeness of a man. Have you really reflected on what the incarnation shows us about the humble heart of God? It shows us that God valued his relationship with us above his own dignity. In spite of being scorned by his own creations, he extended himself to us again. In order to mend the love relationship that we broke, he took the hurt on himself. He took responsibility when he had absolutely no obligation to do so. He owned the guilt that wasn't his. He took the fall. He paid the price to get us back. Although he was fully God in his nature, the Son didn't cling to his rights and his privileges, but instead he emptied himself, not of his deity, but of his divine dignity. Consider, if you will, the humility of God on full display in the utter humiliation of the incarnate Son. Consider the humiliation of infancy. You know, he could have just appeared on the scene in time for his beautiful ministry to begin, but instead we're made privy to all the humiliating details surrounding his arrival on earth as a vulnerable baby. Consider the humiliation of a suspiciously inexplicable pregnancy, a stain that would follow Jesus all of his life. If there are some question marks about your paternity, you can take heart. You have a great high priest praying for you who knows exactly how that feels. Consider the humiliation of being born into abject poverty, unwelcome guests in an overcrowded home, at a most inconvenient time, away in a manger, no crib for a bed, wrapped in strips of linen cloth. And the visitors that came, shepherds, the poorest of all peasants. During his life, Jesus would endure homelessness and hunger and the burden of tax bills. If you faced any of those things, take heart. You have a great high priest praying for you who knows exactly how that feels. Consider the humiliation of childhood and adolescence, submitting to the authority and discipline of earthly parents. I can only imagine how Jesus winced every time his parents brought up the incident. Hey, Jesus, remember that time we lost you in the temple? And your mother thought that you were with me, and I thought you were with your mother? Yeah, good times, Dad, thanks. Consider the humiliation of hailing from the boonies. Nazareth was a hick town with nothing going for it. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? No, it cannot. And yet it pleased the Father that the Son should forever bear the title Jesus of Nazareth. And still around the world today, his followers proudly bear that title in the face of persecution and even martyrdom. They're called Nazarenes. Consider the humiliation of being born into a working class family. Consider the humiliation of manual labor, earning daily bread by the sweat of his brow, the blessed King of the universe who brings forth bread from the earth. Consider the humiliation of receiving only the most basic education. Consider the humiliation of being born under severe political oppression. There was a Roman garrison right next to Nazareth. So there's no doubt that when Jesus used illustrations about Roman soldiers commandeering personal property or conscripting someone to carry their gear, he was speaking from personal experience. Consider the humiliation of subjection to bodily needs and weakness. When in all of eternity was God ever cold or hungry or thirsty or sleep deprived or sore or sick? When did God ever shiver in the darkness of night or swelter in the heat of the day? Jesus fully entered into our human experience. He fully participated in our human experience. Consider the humiliation of subjection to human emotions. When in eternity was God ever overcome with human disappointment or sorrow or grief or anxiety, even anger? I have to say this, if you're struggling to hold it together right now, if you're afraid that you're going to lose it. Take heart. You have a great high priest praying for you who knows exactly how that feels. Consider the humiliation of his identification with sinners in the waters of baptism. When Jesus came to Jordan, John said, "No, Jesus, I don't need to be baptized. You don't need to be baptized. I need to be baptized by you." But Jesus said, "We have to do this, John." Jesus had no sins to repent of, but he was water baptized in order to identify fully with our sinful humanity. That's why Hebrews says he became like his brothers in every way. And when the Father saw that act of humility on the part of the Son, he couldn't contain himself anymore. He broke the fourth wall and he shouted down from heaven, "This is my Son. I love him. I'm proud of him." Then the Holy Spirit couldn't resist, and he had to go be with Jesus, and he fluttered down in the form of a dove. See, that's what humility does. Humility irresistibly attracts the Father because he himself is humble, and like is drawn unto like. God said through the prophet Isaiah, "Heaven is my throne and the earth is my ottoman. I made all these things, they are mine. But the man who catches my attention is the one who is humble and contrite in spirit." Peter said, "God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble." When God saw Jesus' humility, he couldn't help himself for a moment. Consider the humiliation of Jesus' temptation. The immutably holy God, who cannot be tempted with evil, had to endure the loathsome company of the father of lies. Consider the humiliation of living in total surrender to the will of the Father. Jesus said, "I only do what I see my Father doing. I only say what I hear him saying." He relinquished all of his rights. He relinquished all of his ambitions. He denied himself some joyful human experiences that we get to enjoy. Amazingly, humility is the only character quality that Jesus ever explicitly identified about himself. Jesus was wise, but he never said, "I am wise." Jesus was holy, but he never said, "I am holy." But he did say, "Take my yoke and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart, and you shall find rest for your souls." Consider the humiliation of Jesus' itinerant preaching ministry. A career for which he had no formal training nor credentials, a career which made him dependent on the hospitality and offerings of strangers, a career which was an embarrassment to his earthly family. Consider the humiliation of his service to the sick and the broken. Consider the humiliation of being associated with the losers and the unlucky in life, the swindlers and the adulterers. Consider the humiliation of people's ingratitude after he gave so selflessly. Consider the humiliation of being used for gain by your own friends. Consider the humiliation of washing their thankless feet. Consider the humiliation of being scrutinized and interrogated and weighed by your own creations. Consider the humiliation of being misunderstood, underestimated, of having your motives questioned. Consider the humiliation of his rejection. Consider the humiliation of the false accusations, of the betrayal, of his arrest, of being abandoned by his friends. Consider the humiliation of his mock trial, of false witnesses, of the fickle crowd. The same ones who cheered, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," on Monday shouted, "Crucify him," on Thursday. Consider the humiliation of being turned over to unclean Gentile governors. The true king of the Jews was handed over to the Romans by his own people. And then the incarnate Son endured the ultimate humiliation. Paul says, "And being regarded by men as nothing more than a mere man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross." Consider the humiliation of the incarnate Son on the cross. an execution so cruel that Roman citizens could not be sentenced to it. An execution reserved for slaves and the most vile lawbreakers. An execution so grotesque that it was uncouth to even mention in polite conversation. Consider the humiliation of public nudity. Consider the humiliation of the unbearable physical anguish. Consider the humiliation of the monstrous, bloody spectacle. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. We hid our faces from him. Consider the humiliation of being executed alongside common criminals. Consider the humiliation of the jeering crowds and his weeping mother and his absent disciples. And here's the thing about Jesus' humiliation on the cross. Jesus did not come to earth as anything less than God. Jesus was not God with one arm tied behind his back. The thing about Jesus' humiliation is that everything he did as God. The wonder of the cross is not the death of a man who was just a shadow of a deity, but the death of God who had become a man. It was God as a man who hung there in agony as they scoffed, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he really is the Christ of God." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you really are the King of the Jews, save yourself." No wonder Hebrews says, "Consider him who endured such contradiction of sinners against himself." Consider the humiliation of the Son's separation from the Father. For one awful moment, while Jesus bore the sins of the world on the cross, the Father turned his face away from the Son, and an eternity of perfect, unbroken fellowship was shattered. God himself experienced the sting of separation that comes as a result of sin. They crucified the Lord of glory, the author of life, tasted death. And he did it all just to woo us and to welcome us into the relationship that he shares with the Father. But God's humility doesn't end there, because I find that God is still humble. Jesus' earthly ministry is completed, but that doesn't mean that the incarnation is over. The incarnation was permanent. God the Son was forever altered by the incarnation. He ever lives in a body of glorified human flesh. He still bears the wounds of Calvary in his body. When John was escorted into the throne room of heaven, he saw a lion on the throne. And when he looked again, he saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain. In heaven, the Son is worshipped as the Lamb of God. And even in his exaltation, the Son continues to give all glory and all honor to the Father. God has exalted him to the highest place and has given him a name above all names, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Humility is and for will ever be the hallmark of his kingly reign. What does the revelation that God is humble mean to me? Well, for one thing, it's cause to adore him even more. Who would have ever conceived of a selfless, humble God? What other God, worshipped by any other name anywhere else in the world, is said to be humble? When we were on the island of Bali, all over the place outside of homes and businesses, there's little cardboard trays, you know, the kind that you get French fries in at a hot dog stand, and they're full of incense and flower petals and offerings to the gods, and the people make offerings every couple of hours. They make offerings. The missionary told us that the people, the Balinese people, never go on vacation, never leave home, because they're afraid that if someone forgets to put out the offering 3 or 4 times a day to the god, that the God will get angry and curse their family and curse their business and curse their home. That's what other kind of gods do. What other God anywhere in the world is said to be humble? God's humility makes him something uniquely beautiful in all of the universe. Who else is like him? Who else can compare to him? What does God's humility mean to me? Another thing I find is that it's a cause to trust him. The knowledge that God is humble undoes all the lies that the old serpent told about him in the garden. His humility means that he is completely trustworthy. It means that his motives toward me are completely pure and honorable. It means that he has my ultimate good at heart. He has my peace at heart. I can trust him because he would rather suffer injury himself than to leave me in an injured state. I can trust myself to his beautiful leadership because there's no other beautiful king like him. There's no other beautiful shepherd like him. The knowledge that God is humble makes me want to run into his arms. It makes me want to be near him and to never leave him. What does God's humility mean to me? Finally, I find that it's a cause to rest in him. Everybody listen to this for one moment. Jesus said, "When you discover that I am gentle and humble of heart, you will find rest for your souls." You see, the revelation that God is humble means the end of striving for me. Because I understand that God is not impressed by my show of strength. God is not impressed by my competence. He's not impressed by my gifts and talents. He gave them to me anyway. He didn't give me as many as he gave Pastor Nick, but he gave me a few. He's not impressed by my achievements. He's not impressed by my independence. He's not impressed by my holiness nor my good works. In fact, all the things that are valued by men are completely meaningless to God, and they don't attract him one bit. Instead, the humble God is attracted by my brokenness. He's attracted by my admission of neediness. He's attracted by my cries for help. What does the incarnate Son reveal to me about the heart of God? What does he radiate to me about the Father? What does he represent and portray about the Father? 3 things. Worship team, you can come help me finish. God's nature is essentially relational. God's nature is infinitely humble. And finally this. The incarnation shows me that God's nature is to always finish what he starts. Jesus told the disciples one day, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." On the cross, Jesus' last words of humiliation were, "It is finished." Why did God become a man? Because it is not in his nature to start something and not finish it. It is not in his nature to leave broken things broken. It is not in his nature to leave injured things injured. It is not in his nature to leave lost things lost. It is not in his nature to leave losses unrectified. It is not in his nature to leave conflicts unresolved. He is the Prince of Peace. It is not in his nature to leave pain unrelieved. It is not in his nature to leave injustices unredressed. Why did God become a man? Because it is not in his nature to leave his promises unfulfilled. And here's a promise you can take all the way to the bank on this Christmas Sunday morning. If you're in pain, if you're in the middle of a conflict, if you've had a loss, if you're lonely, if there are broken relationships in your life, if there's a mess in your house, if some members of your family are lost right now, God's very nature is to finish the good work He started in you. I am confident of this very thing, that He who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. How do I know? Because the incarnation of the Son tells me so. What does the incarnation show me about the heart of the Father? Our God is relational. Our God is humble. There's no other God like Him. And our God always finishes what He starts. Would you stand on your feet and give a big praise to Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, this morning?